under emotional and personal pressure. That kind of faith is the faith of the church. And to belong to the community of faith means that when my faith is pretty feeble and yours is strong, then we still go on together. And we need, therefore, one another. I need your faith, you need my faith, and together the community of faith will see great things done, because that's the platform on which God works. And some of you will know, of course, that my son was, we prayed over him, and no cancer cell, although it had been in his neck, his arm, his chest, his lung, his spleen, stomach, and also in his spinal fluid. No cancer cell was ever seen again in that moment. So we are very grateful to the faith of the saints. And if you said, was it my faith that healed my son? I would say, do you know, it has nothing to do with my faith. You say, was it your faith? Well, it was more likely your faith. I suppose ultimately it is that which is ministered by Jesus into the body of Christ. And we stand in that together. Now we're going on into our inquiry in faith. It's the title, as many of you will know, is The Life of Faith, or Faith Which is Alive. We live by faith. Now if we're living by faith, then if you've got a life stretched out before you, you wouldn't expect necessarily that your faith would remain exactly the same all the way through the years of your life. A life of faith is an adventure of growing faith, of fighting faith, of developing faith, of stumbling faith, of getting up faith, of going on faith, and faith gets stronger and stronger. Whatever faith is, we'll have to think about that as we go along. Because we know from our Lord's words, there are those of little faith. Oh, you of little faith. And there are those who have weak faith. And those who have wavering faith, and those who have strong faith, and those who have great faith, and those who have faith which is a victory. So I suppose you could call it victorious faith. There are different levels and different aspects of faith. And to think, well, you know, I've got faith and so I'm stuck with it now for the next 50 years until I get to glory, that is not what faith is about. Faith is a growing, developing, organic thing in the spiritual realm of our lives, whereby we grow and get more and more men and women of faith. After all, we are meant to be believers.
Yeah.
I've met some believers and they don't seem to have any faith. And I've met others who are believers and they major on everything but faith. They major on being right. More right than anybody else. Have you met those kind of believers? And if you ask them just to pray for the sick or something, they immediately their knees are as jelly and they don't know what to do. Or if you ask them to come out and talk to somebody in the streets, they're quite turned off. But they're pretty good at writing great articles against you, and they're pretty good at putting everybody else straight. I don't really think that's got anything to do with being a believer at all. That is simply a matter of being religious. And religion loves to destroy, and so it goes about destroying things. And as we go on this evening, for the next 3 or 4 hours at the rate that I'm going now, we will find that there are very, very important principles if we want our faith to grow. And those kinds of things will not support it. They will destroy it. They will cause it to wither. And yet at the same time, I know deep down in my own being, I've been on the road now for some 40-something years, seeking to grow in faith. I'm ashamed how little my faith has grown, but I want to tell you this. I want more faith, I want a deeper faith, I want a greater faith, and a more victorious faith next year than I've had this year, and more the year after that, and more the year after that. Because it is faith that gives God the ground to do great things. And so we're going to look tonight back at Abraham, the father of faith. And we're going to ask ourselves a few questions as to how God developed his faith. And how we too want to go on in that growth and development. So that we can follow from the same things that he went through and find our own lives becoming truly those of believers. First of all, what faith is not. It's Lewis Carroll. You know Lewis Carroll? Alice in Wonderland and all that deep theological stuff? You know? He said that we should practice trying to believe three impossible things before breakfast every day. Now, I'm not quite sure. He was a clergyman, but not quite sure what he was really getting at that, except to perhaps ridicule some people's faith. We shouldn't ridicule anybody's faith, because even the tiniest bit, God is able to do something on. And even if we've got some of our ideas wrong. But I want to make it quite plain to begin with. Trying to believe something which is impossible and which we reckon is impossible, whether God's in the business or not, is not what faith is. It isn't a kind of self-deceit. Let's deceive ourselves and try and pretend something's true that isn't. Or, as some people have defined faith, faith is trying to believe something that you know isn't true. Okay? Trying to believe something you know isn't true. So that is not what faith is about. Faith is not the opposite of reason. If you met people say, well, yes, that's lovely, I'm glad you've got faith, I'm glad you've got a bit of faith, that's really nice and it's good to have a bit around, but you see, I've got reason. Mm-hmm. You've got faith, I've got reason, and those two things don't mix, they're like oil and water, you know, nothing to do with each other. That is absolute, total codswallop. Did you know there was a man called Cod? You don't believe this, but it was. Just in case you think that I was being a little bit sort of vulgar in my invective, there was a man called Cod who lived not far from us in southeast London. I wasn't actually alive at the time, but he produced a factory in which he got water, mineral water, that was somewhat carbonated naturally from the ground. And he put it in a bottle with a marble in the top, and you had to push the marble got pushed up by the little bit of gas, so it was always fixed. You know, one or two of you nodding heads, that gives away how old you are. And you had to push that marble in, and then you could pour the stuff out. And that was what Cod produced. And they called it a drink, or a wallop, you see. You have a pint of wallop, you know, it's a good drink. But the thing is, when the time came and they started to make... You're all very interested in this, aren't you? I mean, when they wanted to make real carbonated stuff, where they put the carbonation in, not just took out the natural stuff out of the ground, then that stuff really had a kick in it. They had plenty of fizz in it, you know, plenty of carbonation. And so poor old Cod's wallop was considered pretty inferior compared to this artificially produced carbonated water. And so eventually he went out of business. But they used to say, well, it's just old codswallop. It meant it had no punch in it. Got the idea? Yeah. Are you with me? Yeah. Now, that's just really for those from the other side of the Atlantic, so you can understand. It ruined the British economy, actually, when he went to ground. But there you are. We have to put up with these things. The fact is that faith is not the opposite of reason. In fact, unless you have got some faith, you won't get very far with reason. You have to have faith in your brain cells. You have to have faith in your appreciation that comes through your five senses. You have to have faith that what's going on inside your mind has some particular relationship to what's going on out there. You have to have faith in order to work out your logical understanding of things. Why should I believe in a lump of mud that's in my head if it was all evolved out of some primeval swamps? Your brain cells, they were evolved out of primeval swamps of mud. Why should I take any notice of what you think at all? You're made to think it by the squelching and squirching of all your mud. Go back millenniums before, and there's a protoplasmic globule squelching out of some primeval swamp, which has come into being through the descent into the abyss of some primeval forest, and carboniferous creations were taking place under the pressures of the supersonic earth of the past. And squelching out, your protoplasmic globule begins to globule along until eventually it swings from a tree, and then it drops on its feet, and then it grows a brain, and then that lump of mud has become your brain cells. Why should I believe in your brain cells? Why should I believe in my brain cells? By faith, I believe that what's going on out there corresponds to what I can see in here and take in here and think in here, and I do it because I've got a good reason for it. The reason is I believe, and that goes back to faith again, that there is a logical, reasonable God called Logos, logic, and he pumped into this world a real world which is consistent, which he goes on maintaining moment by moment in a consistent fashion, and he goes on maintaining my brain cells, as much as some of you don't believe that. And they correspond. I believe in God, therefore I think. Huh?
Yeah.
That is, there is no place for saying reason and faith don't mix. On the other hand, my faith has lots of good reasons. My wife's name is Faith. That's very useful. Graham and I get off the plane and somebody comes to pick us up, driving us home. Don't know what your wife's been up to since you've been away. All sorts of funny people going in and out of your house. Well, I know that. I mean, that's regular. It's like Charing Cross Station anyway. And there's the bloke with the ginger moustache. You know, what's he get up to when you're away? And the fellow with the black beard, you know, he comes along and so on. Now, if I'm a fool, I start saying, what's my wife been up to? And I get all head up. I go rushing in, wife, what's been going on since I've been away? You know, and all the way, who you heard here? And it's divorce in the morning. But if I'm sensible and I use my reason, I say, what do I know about my wife? She's pitched three screaming infants into this veil of tears on my behalf. She's acted as a father when I've been away preaching here, there, and everywhere. She's got a terrific love for Jesus. She gets wonderful insight. She has a vision and a prophetic ministry. She's, you know, we do meet each other occasionally when she finishes a minute. But what do I know about her? Everything I know about her that is that I should trust her. Faith, trust, belief is not without reason. So don't fall into that silly trap and let people fool us. We believe because there are good reasons behind our faith. Very good reasons. In fact, we came to the conclusion we would never be able to understand anything at all if there was not a God to believe in. Let alone, as we shall see in a moment, using our faith, which is the groundwork of a relationship. And that's what we've got to get to eventually. So in order to help us to think through this whole business of faith, and use our reason about faith and try to grow in faith and see how God leads us through life so that our faith will grow and develop and be stronger when we go over to meet him than it was when we first began. Let's go back to Abraham just for a little bit. Do you remember the first picture I pictured up last night was in the first place where actually the word belief is used, the first time that belief is used in Genesis. And it's used in chapter 15 and verse 6. The father of faith, chapter 15 and verse 6. Verse 5 says, and he took him, he took him outside and said, now look toward the heavens and count the stars, if you're able to count them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. Then he, that's Abraham, believed in the Lord, and he reckoned it to him as righteousness. The first time this magnificent, if you like, Reformation word was declared, and it was declared to Abraham, and Abraham believed, and it was counted to him for being right, put right, made right, stood right. Abraham believed, and it was counted to him for righteousness. You're right with God. It happened because Abraham was taken out of his tent, okay, and he was led out into God's tabernacle of the heavens, and he saw the stars, and he thought of the great Creator God who was bowling galaxies into space. We think the universe is big since science has told us that the galaxies are moving away and receding and we can't see some of them and they go on and on. But I want to tell you, Abraham's world was bigger than ours because he thought that you went up there and 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 it never stopped. We know that if you keep going on and on and on and on, it comes around and it hits you in the back because space is curved. Just turn to one another and say, space is curved, did you know? So his universe looked much bigger than ours, because it never stopped. And he believed in God. And he saw the stars. Oh, God can do these things, he can do anything. But if he'd been left in his little old tent, all cramped up, crabbing, cribbed, confined, and so I say that March for Jesus is a good thing, it gets us out of our little old church buildings, invented by the devil to keep us all inside so that nobody knows we're there. Amen. Did anybody say anything? There we all are, huddled inside, looking around at our little church buildings and how are we going to pay the rent and how are we going to do this and how are we going to do that. And there's Sarah over there, and she'll never produce a child. She's well past it, dear, and bless her. God, oh dear. And there's Hagar. Well, I don't know whether she's going to her or not, but I don't, kind of, you know, a bit of legal fiction, make that my son, and well, half a son. Well, not the right one anyway. And there's Eliezer, he's my steward. What a little tiny weeny tent. No wonder God had to take him out. Because faith is not trusting what you can do and what's in your resources. It's walking out into the resources of God. And while you've got your eyes concentrated on, well, if I sort of do this, then I might be able to make that amount of money and pay the bill next week. And after the missionary's been and the pastor's left to look after the gas bill next week, and, well, I might be able to do this if I mortgage that. That's all in our little tiny, tiny, tiny world. And, of course, when you've got a cancer on the doorstep, there's nothing left to do anything about. So you step out of it. I believe all these things that come, I didn't say necessarily every one of them God ordains comes, but everything that comes, every mountain that gets in our way, is another opportunity to grow in faith. And we step outside and we look out into the heavens and we say, oh God, of course you can do it. How can I not believe? Of course I believe in you, you see? So that was the first thing. Get out of our small resources and start looking out into God's. Look away from what we've got and whether I feel I've got a bit of faith or I don't feel I've got, you know people like that, dear? Sunday night, oh, I think I've got a bit of faith tonight. Oh, I'm taking a bit of faith home. Oh, it's wonderful. Monday morning, wrong marmalade for breakfast again. Grief, I've got no faith at all. You feel terrible. Well, that's simply because you're looking for something inside you to make you say, well, I think I feel I've got a bit of faith. But you see, faith is out there in God's tabernacle, in the heavens. Faith is out there where you can go and put your feet on a rock. And then, oh, I feel the strength of the rock going right through me. But while I'm in here trying to see whether I haven't got anything, it's all feeble and weak. Faith doesn't come by looking into my resources and trying to stand on them because they're collapsed. It's getting out into God's resources, putting my feet on his, and oh, I feel good. You feel good because you've taken the right stance. You're standing in God's resources.
Yes.
Now, I'm sorry to be long over that one, but you see, this verse comes up again. It comes up in Romans 4. So let's rush through to Romans chapter 4. Trouble with starting in Genesis. It takes a long while to get anywhere else. Chapter 4 of Romans and verse 1. What shall we say then that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, has found? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? And Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him for righteousness, or as righteousness. Not to the one who works, his wages not reckoned as favor, but to what is due. But to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is reckoned as righteousness. Abraham found something. Then he must have been looking for something. All right? What is it that Abraham, our forefather, found? Verse 1. He found faith. And if you're not looking, well, don't be surprised if sometimes you don't find. And that finding, I've already explained it in a way. You don't find it just by sitting there hoping it might turn up. You step out of yourself deliberately and consciously, and you stand over in the facts of God, and you start to look to him, and suddenly you find you've got faith. Not because you found it in yourself, you found it out there in him and what he's promised. So if you're not looking, don't be surprised if you haven't found. You might trip over it one day, but don't be surprised. Abraham was looking. And I want each of my days, don't you, to be a day when I'm looking for faith. I want to find faith in this event. I want to find faith about that thing. I want to find faith in this particular circumstance. And here comes another panic. What am I going to do? Go desperate. Think last about God. Think first about the
police or the insurance or whatever and go into a flap. Are you different from me? None of you have a flap here, I can see that. But if you're looking for faith, when you get up in the morning, you are looking as to how you can understand God in this thing, how you can find God in that word, how you can find God in that event, or what you should be doing about this one. God, what do you want me to do about this thing that's happening? So you're looking for faith. Abraham found faith because he was looking. If you move on to the end of that chapter, the verse is quoted again. Important verse, this one in Genesis, isn't it? The first verse about faith comes verse 22. Therefore it was also reckoned to him as righteousness. Now that comes after verse 19. And without becoming weak in faith, he contemplated his own body, now as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb, she was 90, yet with respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith. Faith is growing. How did it grow? Giving glory to God. Giving glory to God. And then it says, therefore it was reckoned him for righteousness. Do I want my faith to grow? Give glory to God. Do I want to have more faith tomorrow than today? Then give glory to God. And when you give glory to God, you don't give it to anybody else, and you don't give it to yourself. I almost hesitate to say this, but it is so documented in well-authenticated books that I suppose it doesn't do any harm to say it again. But one of the greatest, I think, ministries between the wars was the ministry of the Jeffreys brothers, Stephen and George Jeffreys. They say they were converts of the Welsh Revival. They say the power that was manifested in their meetings was way beyond anything that was ever seen in the Welsh Revival. And this was within a decade of the revival itself. I have a friend who is in his 80s now who was converted because he saw Stephen Jeffreys pray for a man who had no sight, never had sight, and eyes appeared in the sockets there. And he was not the slightest bit interested. He wasn't even looking for faith. He was one of those guys. He was just taken along. And he's been serving the Lord ever since now into his 80s. The healing power that was manifested, which we want to see again, don't we?
Yes.
That power was manifested there. Now, when he was in South Africa, as I say, I wouldn't tell you this if it weren't, but it was being written up in books and it's been well authenticated by those who were there at the time. He looked out at the vast crowd where many, 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 many people were being healed. And he said, the whole world has come to my feet. And implied that there was worship, you know, they were worshipping him. And Stephen Jeffreys died. Same man went to see him, had to get down on his knees because he was sitting in a chair like this. He had to get and look up onto his face because he was bent, crippled with an arthritic condition. I don't say any more than that there's only one person to give glory to. It seems almost, if I may put it this way, in the universe, a kind of a level on the graph. And we take a bit to ourselves, okay, take a bit to ourselves, well, that's all right. We take a bit to ourselves and then a bit too much. We pass the Rubicon and we go over the level. And I will give my glory to no other. We're here to give glory to God. And what we've been doing, helping Matt tonight, worshipping, enjoying God, loving Him, offering ourselves to Him, not showing off because nobody to show off to here, just simply saying, God, you're wonderful. Whether you want to lift your hand, stand on your head or whatever, oh God, you're marvelous. You know, not trying to impress anybody, just say, God, you're wonderful. Your faith will grow. It'll grow, growing strong in faith, giving glory to God. And that's the kind of faith that Abraham had. And that's the sort of faith that's going to see things change. Finally, you know, it's nothing to do with being finally. It's just a kind of, you know, like Paul in chapter 3 of Philippians, he goes on for two chapters. He says, finally. You heard about the Somerset curate, did you? A new curate came and the church warden was asked down in Somerset how he's getting on with the new curate. He said, oh, we like the new curate, we do, yes. We like the new curate. You see, when he says, in conclusion, he do conclude.
But the vicar, the vicar, when he says lastly, oh boy, does he last. Galatians and chapter 3, this verse is mentioned again. Galatians, get to know our Bibles this way, won't we? Galatians chapter 3, in verse 1, you foolish Galatians, who's bewitched you before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified? There's only one thing I want to know. Did you receive the works of the law? Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or the hearing of faith? Verse 5, does he who provides you with the Spirit and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or the hearing of faith? Even so, in the same way, Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him for righteousness. Verse 6, Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him for righteousness. Therefore, be sure it is those who are out of the faith of the sons of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand in Abraham, saying, all the nations shall be blessed in you. Abraham believed God and was declared right, put right, made right with God. And that was in the context that the gospel was to be preached. And that in Abraham, all the nations, in his seed, would be blessed. And that is the ground on which the Spirit is given and works. And on which miracles are done. Because it is even so, Abraham believed God. Just as it was the hearing of faith that the Spirit of God worked. And that miracles were done. It is the same faith that we have weakly, hesitantly, fumblingly, when we first reach out and say, Jesus, please forgive me. Please come into my life. It's the same faith that reaches out and says in the sight of Christ and him crucified, Spirit of God, come and do things with us. Do miracles in our midst. And the one who ministers the Spirit and the one who ministers miracles does it in the same faith. It is not faith plus something. That was what the Galatians were doing. They were saying, faith's all right to begin with, but now you've got to keep the law. Faith's all right to begin with, but you've got to add something to Christ crucified. Faith's all right, but you've got to have more than faith. Brothers and sisters, you don't have to have more than faith. The kind of faith that works by love, of course, love comes into the picture. But faith is what it means to be a believer. If you were a lawyer or a lawmonger, it would say that lawmongers are blessed of God. But it doesn't. It says believers are blessed of God. And it is the faith that gives ground for the Holy Spirit's working and for miracles to take place. Don't we want the Spirit of God to work? Amen. Don't we want to see more miracles? Then we need to be greater in our faith, even so as Abraham believed God. And it goes on to say that it was through Abraham's faith that ultimately blessing would come to the Gentiles, and that blessing was the blessed gift of the promise of the Holy Spirit. Blessing just means God speaks nicely. Eulogia, beautiful words. Blessing. God speaks nicely about you. God speaks blessing about you. God speaks nice, good things about you. Beautiful words about you. And it's the person who's walking around knowing that God says nice things about them that grows in faith and expects the Spirit of God to do things. You want to be blessed? Well, you are being blessed. God says nice things about you. On the ground exactly as Joe was telling us this morning, that even at the same moment as you came for the first time and the blood of Jesus welcomed you into the presence of God, 40 years later you still come with the blood of Jesus and you're welcomed into the presence of God. It doesn't mean because God blesses us by grace on no grounds of what we are ourselves. It doesn't mean that you can go out and sin to your heart's content, or won't be content, it will be terribly disturbed, and say, I don't care at all about doing God's will. Of course. It's when you want to do God's will, you come and you want to get forgiveness. It's when you want to go God's way that blood is effective. Yes, the blood's in the light of the Shekinah glory, and if you go out of the tabernacle, it's dark out there. If you come into the holy place, it's light in there, and the light shines on the blood. And you know you're welcome before the Lord. Am I giving you any problems over there with the camera? Well, I'll try and keep
a bit more sort of stilled. Now, this is just the introduction. You're all happy about this, aren't you? I mean, you've all got beds booked in tonight. James and chapter 2. This is the final time that this most important verse about Abraham believing God, and he therefore was righteous or put right, made right, set right. This is the last time it comes. Can I just say a word about that, incidentally? If you've got a socket in the wall there, and you've got a plug with 3 pins, when you put the plug right, you put it into the socket. Power flows. To be put right with God is to be plugged in. And to be put right with God, you need the blood of Jesus. And you do it by faith. If I didn't believe there was any current in that wall plug there, I wouldn't put my plug into it, would I? But because I believe that there's current there, I stick the plug in and something happens. And when I again put right with God, Abraham believed God and he was put right with God. When he was stuck into the plug, the power flows. And all of God's resources are available. And it's to be kept plugged in. Get plugged in. Now, we're getting a bit deeper when we get to James here, because James says in verse 23, the scripture was fulfilled which says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Oh, I'm sorry, chapter 2, verse 23. And he was called the friend of God. You see, faith isn't a kind of a lump of something. It gets bigger each day. Oh, it's come out. Oh, it's going down again. And faith is the groundwork of a relationship. Faith is the groundwork of a relationship. I use my illustration about my wife, Faith, you know. That if you have no faith, you have no relationship. Because some people think it's rather funny. Why shouldn't God have saved us by baptism? Or why shouldn't he have saved us by going and touching the cross? Or why shouldn't he have saved us by saying, keep the Ten Commandments? Or why shouldn't he have saved us by letting us stand on our head for 6 hours or sit on a pole like Simon Stylites? Why doesn't he save us? Why does he have to save us by faith? Isn't faith a bit of an odd thing? Have you met people like that? Why faith? It's a bit unfair. I haven't got faith and you've got faith. I haven't got it. Why should God only save those who've got faith? Faith is what a relationship is made of. Trusting God is the basis of having a relationship with him. And our God is a relationship God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are just a great bunch of relationships. They always have been, and they always will be. And therefore, it's no good us complaining and saying, I'd rather be saved by eating chewing gum or something stupid. I've got to be saved by what God is, which is a bunch of relationships. Which he, in his great love and mercy and wonder, having made us in his image, says, I want you to share these relationships. So I have to have faith to trust him and enter into a relationship with him. There is nothing more fundamental about a God of love than that he's a relationship God. Because love requires relationship. Love can't be a dictator. If you've got a husband or a wife who's a dictator, you can't have any love. Sorry about that, but it's got to be a shared thing. 50-50 or 40-60 or something, but it's got to be. And you've got to trust one another in that 40% or that 60%, whatever it is. And then you've got a relationship. Day by day by day by day, God is saying, come into my relationship. Come and enjoy a relationship with me. Come and share what it means to know me as a friend. Abraham believed God and he was called the friend of God. You like faith? It's a good thing, isn't it? I'm glad that there's some faith around, because without that we'd never have any relationships at all. And life is about relationships. Human life is knowing people, sharing with them. Married life is a relationship between a husband and a wife. Divine life is that you should know God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent. This is life eternal. Isn't it? Life is always a shared relationship. An eternal life is a shared relationship. So here I am wanting a relationship with God, wanting to live in a place of trust and confidence in him. And it grows and it waxes and wanes, it gets bigger and smaller, but as it goes on getting stronger and stronger, more and more and more things can happen. Now, I want to go back to the very beginning, and you're getting worried at this stage because you think this will take an awful long time. I promise you it won't. That's if I don't get tempted to give you too many illustrations. But we're going back to the beginning of Abram's life. And it says in the Acts of the Apostles, and also a hint in Nehemiah, that there was a day when Abraham was living in Ur of the Chaldees, and the God of glory appeared to him in Ur of the Chaldees. And that is how faith begins. A revelation of the glory of God touched Abraham's heart. And as it touched his heart, something was left there. This is found in chapter 11. The actual engagement or the encounter isn't mentioned, but obviously something had happened. The God of glory appeared to him when he was in Ur of the Chaldees. That's what it says in the Acts and what it's hinted at in Nehemiah. When you've seen something about Jesus, when you've seen something of his glory, a little bit of glory gets left inside you. And that acts like a magnet. And that is the driving pull all the time of faith. It's the vision of the God of glory that eventually makes you get up and go 1,000 miles across the desert, leaving your wonderful home behind and all the civilization, the richness and the consumerism of Babylon. It was probably just as powerful as we've got it today. But you have caught a sight of Jesus. Tell me not of aught beside. I have seen the face of Jesus. All my soul is satisfied. And you begin to want to go out after him. That's the beginning of a faith life. The God of glory has touched you. The God of glory has begun to woo you. Didn't that happen? Well, it's as fresh to me as the day it happened when I was a student at university, and I can see a man talking about Jesus, and I'd already read one or two books, but as though God was pointing at Jesus on the cross and saying, "That's how much I love you." And I knew. I knew when I looked at that, I knew that nothing else made sense in the whole universe. If God wasn't like that, then he wasn't worth having. If God wasn't like that, then he probably wasn't. And if you said it was too good to be true, that a God would come and lay down his life for his friends, for his enemies, if you said it's too good to be true, I'd say to you it was so good it had to be true. So good it has to be true. You understand me? If God then isn't like that, then he's not worth having. It's so good it must be true. If there is a God, he's got to be like that. And it gets inside you and you can't get it out. At least, it's foolish to try and get it out. It begins to draw you. You say, the God of glory appeared. But then, as soon as you begin to step out in the sight of that vision, to go where he's calling you and leave behind those other things. You see, Dad comes in on the business, and Terah only let him go so far, and they got stuck at Haran, and they couldn't go any further. And so God has to speak again, because you see, as soon as you start a life of faith, you will find the enemy is at work to try and hinder you. He can't obliterate the vision. That'll always be there. You've met people years and years after who, through a relationship, through parents, through a husband or a wife, through kids, they got stuck, but there's still something there. And years later, they bemoaned the fact, and they wanted to go out after and further, but they got stuck at Haran. And that's the first thing the devil will use to try and hinder you. So God has to speak to Abraham again and said that he leave your family, leave your household, and leave your land, and leave Haran, and come into the land which I am calling you. Because faith is a relationship with God, it is relationships which first get in the way of preventing us from going after him. I'm not saying that therefore you have to bust up your relationships, but your relationship with God comes first. To love him comes first. Now, you may say, as I remember I said to God at one time, you think it's hard, an old guy like me could have ever had such thoughts. I said, God, I don't know how I can love you more than I love my intended wife. I've wanted her so much. Yeah? And you know what the Lord said to me? He said, you just go on loving me and I'll look after that. And he will. A love for God must supersede any other. I wouldn't have married my wife in the end if she didn't love Jesus more than she'd love me. Because that's the only way a decent marriage is going to work. And stupid, egotistical men who somehow think when their wives get converted that they've got a competitor in on the scene. Not only need to have their heads tested, they need to repent. Anybody that prevents anybody following Jesus is a very serious crime. God will call them to account. But that's what happens, and Abraham had to go through this test. God tested Abraham, and he breaks through it, and his faith grows. And he starts off and he's into chapter 15, hasn't gone very far. And the next test comes. This time the test is fear. Although God had said to him, I'm calling you out so you can be a blessing to the nations, and he might have put in brackets, and especially Egypt, when he gets in touch with Egypt, he's afraid. And so he tries to pass his wife off as his sister. And it was half true, and it was half therefore untrue, because she was his half-sister. But we'll forget that bit for a minute. And he was trying to palm her off as though she wasn't his wife. Hardly the decent way to treat a lady, but anyway, that went on. And when they discovered it, to his amazement, the fear was unnecessary. He got ladled up with goods and pushed out of the land. They didn't want him. They didn't want him there. I mean, who wants a believer who's half a believer? And, you know, so they pushed him out. And they pushed him back into the land where he was supposed to go. Thank God that he doesn't give up on us when even we take steps to go the wrong way. He still goes on working, and to our surprise. Now, how many of you found this? How many found this? You have feared something, but when you've actually entered into that situation, it was only a fraction of what you feared. Well, then let's pack up bothering to fear about it anyway, because the Lord is with us. And fear will kill faith. Fear paralyzes faith. Fear got Peter beginning to drop in the sea. And when he saw the waves, he feared. And fear is a terrible thing against faith. And what a believer has got to learn is how to deal with fear. And to deal with fear, you have one or two experiences of fear, and you begin to realize that God's still got his hand on you. You say, well, the third time it comes along, or the fourth time, he's going to take me through this. Is that the idea? And you don't fear it like you did before. Because the Lord is teaching you, and your faith is growing. And you're going to say, I'm going to trust in God in this situation. And then he gets back and builds an altar, and he worships where he went wrong. We're back to a little bit more worship, and perhaps we haven't been worshiping enough, so our faith has been letting us down. Now we've got to worship and get back into a place where we're in touch with him. I was going to say, you know, as a separate entity, faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God, but why don't you worship when you read the word of God? That is the way to read it. When you read the scriptures, worship. Thank Jesus for what you're reading. Thank him for what he's doing. And as you go through anything, just talk to the Lord about what you're going through. And as you build an altar, as you're just not just, dare I say, cerebrally and intellectually trying to draw up another theological volume and trying to outright somebody else who's defeated your theology and you want to put it right, but you're actually using the Bible to commune with God and to worship God and to love God and build an altar, then that's the way to hear the word of the Lord. That's how the word will come to you. That's how it'll come alive to you. And the scripture will bring the word into your own heart and life, and you know that you're seeing something fresh about Jesus. And even when you get to those very interesting bits, like, you know, Malachel Ahasbaz begat Shear, Jesu begat Jehoshaphat begat, you know that, do you enjoy those bits? Well, put your finger down them one by one and say, goodness me, Lord, if you could love people like that, you would. And your faith will grow because you're worshipping. So, build an altar and you start to worship again. Then something else happens, chapter 15. God calls him to establish the covenant. And he lays out sacrifices, cuts them actually. You used to cut a covenant, and so he cut the sacrifice. And cutting the covenant meant that the two parties will walk between the pieces of the sacrifice. And it was as though they were saying, if I break this covenant, chapter 15 of Genesis, if I break this covenant, if I break this agreement, then let me be like these torn apart animals. That was cutting a covenant. And Abraham laid the pieces out, but God hasn't turned up yet. And so he can walk between them, but there's not much point in one person in the covenant walking between the pieces. He's got to have two. And the birds start to come as he waits patiently. Some people, sometimes our faith doesn't grow because we don't wait patiently. In patience, we inherit the promises. And promises are inherited by faith. And as he walks and waits, he sees the birds coming. They're trying to eat up the sacrifice. So you can just see him with a big stick running around, whacking at them, trying to keep them off. Because he starts to get a bit aggressive against those that would take away his confidence. And there are some times when it's far better than just sort of whispering quietly and sort of saying, well, I feel pretty grim today, so I'll give in. Well, I've still got a bit of faith left. To get up and shout at it and tell it to get out. and say, in the name of Jesus, get out of my life. In the name of Jesus, get out of that person. In the name of Jesus, get out of these circumstances. My wife may be a bit extreme, but when she's caught in London traffic, she starts speaking to the cars in front. Make way, in Jesus' name. Embarrassing thing is that as much as I tell her not to do it, it sort of works. I'm very embarrassing. But there are times when you need to move with that kind of aggression to keep the birds off, because they're going to chew it up and destroy what you're waiting for. And you're sitting it out there as a demonstration that you do trust. You do believe he's going to turn up. You follow? Sometimes we give up too quickly, don't we? We want to stick there and keep... I could give you a lot of illustrations. Just one of our ladies now, who's just come back from Afghanistan. One of the Taliban broke in. Well, they're breaking in day and day out. But he broke in and was taking her computer and a few things, and she just gets out and walks out and said, "In Jesus' name, put it down!" And the chap dropped it and ran. He was a soldier, a Taliban soldier. Wonderful. Remember the first time I was attacked by a male witch. I didn't know what to do. I mean, it was just coming at me. I just, in the name of Jesus, and he fell on the ground. Oh, goodness me. It's being a little bit aggressive, you see. And when our son, I must have told you about when we went into the hospital and prayed over Chris, when he was there with this cancer thing all over him. Well, the consultant, this is a light interlude in between, the consultant said, "Well, you can come in when I'm going on the rounds," because they thought it would do these funny Christians good, you see, to have a little placebo effect if we go in and did a bit of praying. So while his round was on, they said, "Well, we'll pull the curtains round." Well, they pulled the curtains round my son's bed, and there were four of us there, my wife, myself, and a chap who had more experience in healing than I'd had at that time. And we all stood round the bed, and we began to pray. Well, I don't think I'd ever prayed so aggressively in my life as I began to pray. I just saw this wretched, stinking cancer. I wanted to pull it out and throw it down and jump on it and curse it and throw it and... I didn't mind whether I blessed it or cursed it. I didn't know what I was saying half the time. I just wanted it to go. And when we came from behind the curtains... the consultant had gone. I mean, it's a bit difficult to walk round, isn't it, and pick up the... Oh, yes, yes, yes. To the matron and the students, you know, cut his leg off and... oh, poke his eye out, you know, all that sort of thing. But he'd gone with all his retinue, his entourage, and we came... And all the people in the bed were... But I said to myself, I'm going to lose my son. I'm going to lose him fighting. Going down fighting. Beat the birds off. You know? And then God did turn up as a fire went between the pieces. And Abraham actually got to sleep, but he was still there. And God was able to deal with him and confirm the covenant. Chapter 16. Another temptation. We start off in the spirit, and then we decide, well, we better go for it in the flesh. We've waited long enough, there's no child there. It's a kind of in those days, a servant girl could have a child on behalf of her mistress, and so go into Hagar, and it's just simply the flesh trying to reproduce what was ordained in the spirit. And we start off in the spirit, and we finish up running everything in the flesh. Does that sound extreme? Haven't you seen ministries that have gone that way? Start off in the spirit and you finish up running everything in the flesh. Being clever, manipulating people, trying to get money out of people. Got to keep this big show that I've put on the road, I've got to keep it going. You've met this sort of thing. And gradually it's all just a matter of a great business. And you're an entrepreneur putting a business over, trying to keep... And I just don't know in the end, I mean... God knows, it's not for us to judge our brothers in these ways, but I just don't think much of the kingdom comes out of that stuff in the end. Kingdom comes with ordinary people like ourselves here, just saying, Lord Jesus, we want everything you've got. We want to stand for you. We want to be trusting in you. And all sorts of wonderful things happen. Running a big show which requires loads of fleshly activities to keep it alive. But allowing for that, anyway, the child's born, Ishmael is there, we've got a problem. And Ishmael, you remember, and Sarah then gets jealous and throws Hagar out, and then God has to send her back, and it's a mess. It's a mess there. So in chapter 17, God calls Abraham again. And he, through this problem, through this difficulty, wants to get him out of the flesh and into the spirit. Even at this point, Abraham is saying, let Ishmael live before you. Let Ishmael live before you. And that isn't the one. God hasn't chosen this way. This isn't the one the Lord is working through. And he says, he tells him he's going to have this child. And you remember, I'm doing this quickly so that if I pointed to all the verses, we'd take all night. But Abraham laughed. Now, some people think it was a laugh of faith. I don't think it was. I think it was a laugh of unbelief. What, me, 100 years old, and Sarah, 90? I don't think it was a laugh of faith. Not at that point. But God then says to him, I'm going to call the child Isaac. Now, that was a laugh, wasn't it? It means laughter. Isaac means laughter. So here is Abraham laughing, perhaps in unbelief, and God saying, okay, you want to laugh? I'm going to call this child Isaac. Laughter. Because laughter is the way to go out in faith. To laugh. To be happy. Miserable Christians do not get very far in the life of faith. Is that right? Miserable Christians just make other people miserable. It's amazing how easily you can minister misery. I have a ministry of making people miserable. Yeah. Some people like that. Anybody can be miserable. It's dead easy. Just relax and you can be miserable. I mean, so many things to be miserable about, isn't there? It doesn't need very much effort to be miserable. But it does mean a continual exercise of enjoying the Lord and being happy in the Lord. Can I put it this way? Let each one of us be as happy as we can be. Now, it won't be the same every day. But let us be as happy as we can be for our brother and sister's sake. So that we can keep them happy. And the laugh of faith will eventually be there. The joy of faith. The laughter that causes us to say, I believe. Maybe this is one of the things that Toronto was saying. If not everything it was saying, I don't know. But it was certainly saying, there's a lot of laughter around in the presence of God. There's a lot of joy in the presence of the Lord. In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And therefore, to encourage one another with laughter and not with misery. We owe it to our brothers and sisters, because most of them are carrying all sorts of problems and burdens and difficulties. I bet if I went around the room tonight, you'd all tell me straight away, without stopping to think, what your main burden is, what your main misery is, what your main problem is, wouldn't you? We've all got them. In fact, if you started with me, I'd go on for an awful long time. But there is a discipline, and that discipline God will help us in, that even when we're laughing in unbelief, he'll make it into a joke that makes us smile and laugh about God. This is a silly thing. I don't know if it's even a joke, but it's a strange the things that God uses. I don't know why this one came to my mind, but it might mean something to somebody. I've been doing a crossword puzzle, and I got a couple of words, and I got stuck on them, and at last I saw them, these two words. And I went to a couple we've prayed for many times who haven't had a child yet. We've had a lot of success with children. I told you about one, I think, last night, being conceived by people long-term, no child. And this couple, they're particularly precious to us. They're very close to us in the work in London. And we prayed for them again just a few days ago. And as my wife and I finished praying for them, I said, well, I've got this silly thing. I've got nothing else in my mind, but this is what God, I think, brought there. But it doesn't. And I told them this crossword clue, you know, in these two words. Crossword clue. I mean, it must have really got into my system. But anyway, the Spirit of God pulled it out. And the two words that I used were involved with an actual activity in a place that they had been to over their particular problem. And it just, they were just gawped at one another. I won't tell you what the thing is, because it might create too much of a suspicious inquiry, but it was that they had been looking in a certain place in Britain. They'd moved from London, they'd gone to this place, and they'd gone to a clinic and a few other things, and these two words just covered that whole activity. He said, well, maybe God's taking us through there. My faith rose. Although it was such a silly thing. In fact, you know, I look back and I have a laugh at it, really. Sometimes you do, and it helps your own faith when you're feeling depressed and low. I had a couple, it was 2 or 3 years ago now, but it's about 2 years, I think. I was in Spring Harvest, and we were having a time of being filled with the Spirit, and folk waited behind, and after the main meeting, we were going around praying for them. And I came to this fellow, and I started to pray for him, and he stood there like this. And I prayed, and I prayed my heart out, you know, and I thought to myself, whatever I pray, he's never going to fall over, stand up, sit down, and do anything. He's just like this. And after I've been praying like that for about 10 minutes for him, suddenly he said, you've prayed for me before. That's not too encouraging, you understand. You read between the lines, and the devil whispers in your ear, and nothing happened that time, did it? I can see there are one or two others of mediocre faith in this place, like me. And as he said that, I sort of, my heart dropped a bit. Oh, yeah, okay. And then I tried to pray a bit, and then he said, I was epileptic. I said, yes. He said, I drive a car now. I said, you got healed, you know. That's good, yeah. Thinking to myself, he might have told me before. So, now I got praying, and I really started to go to town, and for some reason I started to call him Jim. I don't know why, but something came back from the past, where I came, Jim this, Jim the bless, Jim all, you know, I'm really going to town now. And I felt that the thing I should be praying for, whether he obviously had a very low view of himself, and he didn't really experience very much of God's love, so I wanted him to feel the Father's love. So I was praying like this. And after a while, his wife leant across, who was standing on the side of him, and she said, his name's not Jim, you know. And I thought, this is a good night, isn't it? She said, it's Eddie, and he hates it. And he butted in and said, it's Edgar, and I hate that. I hope there's no Edgar here tonight who I'm upsetting. But he didn't like it. I said, yes, all right. So I, you know, prayed a bit more about him knowing God's love, and then he said, but my middle name's James. I said, well, look, don't you see that you don't like yourself? You know, it was obvious, really, wasn't it? I didn't have to say anything. But God does, and the middle name is, you know, let him use that one, and God will bless, and so on and so forth. But what I'm trying to say is that sometimes God does have a little bit of a joke. When you're trying to pray for people and to get through with something that's worthwhile, you might get the most silly kind of word come to your mind, but it's still worth bringing it out and believing that God's power is behind it, and your faith grows, and you're prepared to do it next time, and you will find the Lord at work. So, where are we at? Chapter. I will finish it. Chapter 18 I left out the story. I think I ought to really mention it. I left out the story of when he went after his brother, after his nephew. Do you remember? In chapter 16, I jumped that chapter, and he had to bring him back. And there were these kings, Chedorlaomer and Shinar and so on, and he defeated them. And when he did, he met Melchizedek just before he met Sodom. The king of Sodom was coming out to meet him, but Melchizedek intervened, got in there first, and broke bread and gave him bread and wine. And then he met the king of Sodom, And he was strong enough to say, I don't want any of the glory, I don't want any of the treasures. Let the people who came with me have their bit. And it was that was chapter 14, that's right, and he sat down, and then he was a bit moany about, you know, I haven't got any treasure, and God has to say, I'm your treasure. But that, bringing his brother back, can I just take one point out of that? Bringing back his nephew, saving a member of his family there. You might have said that he could have done, as we're going to read in a moment in chapter 18. Why didn't he leave his nephew there? After all, he insisted on separating and having a squabble and going off with his herdsmen. Why couldn't he just have left the kings? Why did he risk his life and go after him, having to collect 15 people and charging after this king? Well, he didn't, because he acted in a brotherly way. And he had a concern for his relative. Some of us don't grow in faith because we don't act brotherly. We don't think that brother's worth going out after anyway. Anyway, he's criticized you, spoken ill of you, competed with you, tried to put you down, written an article against you. And you think, well, the best thing to do is leave him alone. Let's get as much distance between us as possible. Abram said he's been living in Sodom. He's going to need help. I've got to get him back. And brotherliness is a necessity for growing in faith. And I would suggest one principle is, if we can't say something good about a brother, don't let's say anything at all. Just keep quiet. He is a brother. Well, after all, even if it was our enemies, I love that story in the days of the Anabaptists where the troops came to get this brother, this man who was in a house, and to take him down to the courts, and he ran out the back door across the dike that was frozen, and as he went out across the dike, the soldiers saw him, went out, came to the water, stood on it, because their armor was so heavy and their armaments, the ice broke. Now, some people might have said, good Old Testament precedent, going through the Red Sea, the horse and the rider, he thrown into the sea. Oh, that's God's provision. But he loved his neighbor. He loved his enemy. He turned around and pulled them out, saved their lives. That freezing cold water, I mean, they'd be finished in a few minutes. He pulled them out. They arrested him, took him down to the marketplace and burned him to death as a heretic. But that is the way of Jesus. And even if your brothers are going to burn you to death, it's far better to love them, to go after them when they're in trouble, and try not to speak ill of them, because otherwise our faith will grow dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. I don't believe faith grows if you continually run down other people's and criticize them and negative about them. Well, here's Lot in trouble again, because Sodom is going to be destroyed. And you remember how in prayer he tries to change God's mind. Moses does change God's mind. And in fact, there is a sense in which God's mind is changed. God says, shall I reveal this thing to Abraham, since he will teach his children the way they should go? Shall I keep this from him, or as a secret? And then he said, no, I won't. I'll reveal it. Because God does nothing, save he reveals it to his servants, the prophets. So somebody's got to listen. If nobody's listening to God, that's why he doesn't do anything. And so here's Abraham listening, and he tells him he's going to destroy Sodom because of its sin. And he said, well, for 50, 45, 30, goes right the way down to 10, you know the story well. That kind of praying is praying. And that kind of praying is praying in faith. That kind of praying knows when God brings the number down. And with 10 people, Sodom would have still been there in the days of Jesus. Jesus said if a few miracles had been done in it, like he'd done in Bethsaida, Sodom would still be there. So whose fault was it that Sodom has to go? Well, it's the fault of the lack of 10 righteous men. No. We've had prophets come to us and tell us the first H-bomb is going to drop on London, they used to say, a good while back now. And I don't know whether we meant to go and dig out fallout shelters in Scotland or something, or buy lots of cans of corned beef. But our guys just simply said, well, the first bomb's going to drop on London. We're going to get more saved before it drops. Get as many people into glory as we can. Same prophecy, but different response. See the idea? And here was the prophecy, and here's Abraham trying to get as much out of it as he can. Couldn't even get 10. But his prayers weren't wasted. And the prayer of faith is never wasted. Prayer of faith never wasted. God did get 3.5 out. I think you can only really count Mrs. Lott as half, because you know, she didn't quite make it, did she? But so God did answer prayer, because Lott would have gone down with the rest if Abraham hadn't prayed. But he got them out supernaturally, a couple of angels dragging them out. So a miracle took place. That wasn't a waste. But Abram's faith grows as he learns to have dealings with God on that level. It's getting deep. I call it prophetic prayer. You're getting deeper and deeper into God's heart. You can talk to him in this kind of way. And your faith's getting deeper. Chapter 20. Nearly there, aren't we? Nearly got to the end of his story. Chapter 20, Abraham has Sarah once again taken off into a harem of Abimelech. Abimelech has a dream. God has stopped up the wounds of his concubines and of his wives in the palace. God speaks to him, says, I will speak to my prophet Abraham, and he will pray for you. Now, can you imagine that? Year after year after year after year, he's been waiting for a child. I will speak to my prophet, and he'll pray for all your jolly old concubines. You probably have more children every year than you could cope with. He'll pray that their wombs open up. Have you ever prayed for somebody when you haven't got the answer in your own life? That's faith. And I think God will give you opportunities for this. You haven't seen it resolved yet in your own life. You haven't seen perhaps a healing in your own life. But it's easier to pray for somebody else. Do you know that? Easier to pray for somebody else than it is for yourself. And if you pray for somebody else, it's amazing how God blesses you too. Because faith is not for us, it's for everybody else. I've already made that hint before. Abraham's faith was so that everybody, all the nations of the earth might be blessed, all the families might receive the good news. So his faith wasn't for himself, it was for everybody else. If I've got any faith, it's for your sake. If you've got any faith, it's for my sake. That the community of faith can move on. And if you've got unbelief, it's not going to do me a lot of good. I've got unbelief, it's not going to do you much good. So, oh God, help me today. Help me to walk in faith. Help me to find faith in everything that I'm doing. Help me to live in faith. I want to bring our relationship into all that's taking place so that other people's faith can grow. Until we get to the place of the 22nd of Genesis and into the hands of God, he has to place his son. Now don't forget, Isaac is not only the beloved son. Three times it says, take now your son, your only son, your son, your only son, your son, your only son. Translated in the Greek, monogenes, is only, that is, beloved son. Take your beloved son and offer him up as a burnt sacrifice, a burnt offering. Whew. Can you imagine it? It wasn't only that it was his only son, it was his whole theological grasp. It was his whole theological library was in that boy. All that he'd known of God, all he'd trusted in God, his whole faith life was in that child. You've got to offer up that child as a burnt offering. Burn it up. Burn up the child so there's no just dust left. Now, has this God who's been taking him through all these journeys and all these experiences of faith, has he been wasting his time so that at the end it's just all abandoned? Abraham says no, the answer must be resurrection. That's why he says to the men at the bottom of the hill, I and the boy will go and worship, and we, hidden sometimes in the translations, it's in the Hebrew, we will come again. Now that was a statement of faith. You need at times what God's put in your heart to speak it out. We believe, therefore we speak. With the spirit of faith we speak out, says Paul in Corinthians. And you speak out what God's put in your heart. And here it was that a resurrection must take place. There is no other solution. I want to halt on that for a minute because there's something I think you'll find helpful. It's just come to my heart. But do you remember when Jesus is tackled by the Sadducees who didn't believe in the resurrection? And he answers them and says, the resurrection is in the Pentateuch. It is in the book of Exodus, because God says he's not God of the dead, he's the God of the living. But that isn't resurrection at first sight. That just looks like life after death. That is just the afterlife, that he's God of the living. And Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is still the God of the, he's still their God as they're in Hades. No, but it's not. It is an answer to the Sadducees. It isn't just that he's the God of the afterlife, he's the God of the resurrection. Because the implication is this: if God has salvaged Abraham again and again and again and again, do you think he'll get to the end of his life and say, oh, well, that's finished now, and finally drop him there? What's the point of salvaging us in our three-dimensional life now if there's not going to be a salvage at the end? There will be a resurrection. We've not got a God who's wasting his time saving us and saving us and answer prayer and answer prayer and giving us exploits of faith in order that then we drop into the place of Hades. We are going to rise again. And that was what was implicit in this exercise as he goes up the mountain. God will have to raise up Isaac again. It's the only solution. And in those lovely words that Joe said to us this morning, I found it very moving, that in the covenant relationship, God was asking Abraham to do what he was going to do. I think there's a terrific amount. It's a terrific amount. Because you see, if Abraham was able to do it, he was only able to do it because God's resources were enabling him to do it. The kind of God who's going to do it himself. The kind of God who's got that potential within him. And when Abraham does it, then something special happens on that spot. Now please, just think about this. I'm not making great statements, but I want us to, well, maybe it is a great, I don't know, but the fact of the matter is that's where Jesus was offered up and died. That's where God did it. So perhaps that very action was necessary for the kind of God that we've got. That kind of God that we've got is a God of cooperative. He's not a dictator. He doesn't push everybody around. He won't even come and save the world unless there's somebody opening the gate in faith. And that claiming the ground 2,000 years later, you remember Jesus said, Abraham saw my day and rejoiced. He was looking down to the day when God was going to do it. And he's going to do it in this very same spot. And there are times when God so moves us and leads us and we prophesy in a certain place or in a certain person in a certain way, and it claims ground for God to do most wonderful things in them. Mm-hmm. Maybe we've even passed away, 2,000 years have gone, but God's doing something there. Maybe nobody has thought of knowing Abraham. Perhaps he died in obscurity and nobody bothered. But hallelujah, he's with us today still by what he did, and that Jesus could die at Calvary in the very ground that he claimed because God found somebody who he could work with. Mm-hmm. God found somebody that he could do some redemptive action into this world with. And that is what he's wanting to do with the church. And even if we die in obscurity, we don't die in obscurity because God's with us. And the great glory of that vision of the God of Calvary, with Calvary love pouring out 2,000 years before the cross, pouring out 2,000 years after the cross. We die in the sight of that, and that's where we live. You can't die in the sight of that. The God who's done all that for us is the God who's so alive that in his presence we have life, and that life of faith has grown and grown and grown. And the day we go over to meet him will be a wonderful day. We won't even notice the difference as we step through into that wonderful presence of God, knowing that this is the God that we've known all the way through our lives, by faith, in trust, with a relationship. There no stranger God will greet you, stranger to the courts above. He who led you, fed you, kept you, welcomes you with well-known love. Isn't that going to be lovely? Is it wonderful? That's the God that we can really get to know by faith, to let our faith grow. Amen? Let's just pray for a few minutes. Jesus. Yara Sandara Shara Barakusia Maryanda Shira Bakusha Sandra Shira Maryanda Shara Sandra Shira Maryanda Sandra Shira Maryanda Sandra Shira. I believe that there are one or two of you you've got words for this very place we're standing on here now. And if you would like to release them, please do. Jesus. And the work that has gone on here over the years. Jesus. Jesus. We're probably standing on ground where others have prophesied and claimed it, that God's work should be done. Now we want to go on into the future. So if your hearts move, you speak forth. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Have in your heart a prophecy for the very ground of the land of Ireland, all its history there. Let's redeem it, claim it. Jesus, 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 Jesus.
Broken forth upon mine enemies before me at the breach of waters. God's word is a battle axe. We are God's battering rams that bring down the walls of Satan. Battering rams in the Old Testament were used to bring down the walls of a fort or city. When we batter the walls of Satan with God's word, the Spirit of God and his angels are activated. God's word is water. It hits the wall until it weakens. We must keep on hitting the target until the walls come tumbling down. Hold fast to the profession of your faith. Persevere. Be persistent. God's word says, you are my battle axe. You are my weapons of war. Examine ourselves and make sure, as Abraham stood before God to intercede, he asked the Lord if there be 50 righteous men, and it was brought down to 10. But we must, when we're standing, we must make sure that we are in right standing with God as we travail and as we battle for Ireland. As the Lord is going to pour out revival over Ireland, we must persevere and hit the wall of religion.
Jesus.
I felt that the water needed to be broke for the child to be born.
That's right.
That's all I felt, you know, and I just want to share to confirm what Pat said. Yes, break through the water. Water must be broke before the baby's born. Mm. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
I would like to share what the pastor's wife said last night. In Dumfries, Scotland, I have been in pastor of the large church in Glasgow, Pentecostal Church. We share that the best word was just heard in the world is now. When a man takes a sledgehammer to a brick wall, may take many blows to destroy the wall or even make any apparent impression upon it. He could make 99 blows on this wall and it still appears as solid